say that to you about booking.
Mr. Thompson, are we, time-wise, and I don't know if that's one of the reasons it's happening, as to when Mr. Saunders would have known the amount of money that he had gotten from this, forget the last name.
Ms. Swain?
Not Ms. Swain.
Oh, Ms. Hudson?
Yes, Ms. Hudson.
Okay. What's the question, Jeff?
Whether he would remember when, if there was some testimony or something about when he became aware of the amount of money he received from Ms. Hudson. I don't know if there was testimony.
Right, there was a testimony that was in an envelope.
I guess
yes, that question. Yeah, the answer is
this question.
Do you remember, Mr. Saunders, you might have testified about it on direct, possibly, about whether you, when she gave you the money, that you didn't even know it was money. Mm-hmm. Or you did know it was money.
No, I didn't know it was, money. She told me don't open the envelope while we was at dinner.
And then you opened it after dinner?
Yes, after we had lunch.
Okay. And that was before you were pulled over after leaving the apartment?
Yeah, that was before.
Judge, I was seeking a little help in trying to do this. Judge, we can arrange to have this printed out, so to say. So, but right now, I understand proceed the way you indicated earlier?
Sure.
I mean, Your Honor, alternatively, I'm willing to stipulate that the defendant has in possession a picture on his phone that I didn't count them all. It shows multiple $50 bills.
And explain the solid card with some writing on it?
They're partially obscured, but I can accept that it's $1,000 total, and it's next to a card that says, thank you. It's always being my...
Yes,
says something, thank you for being my something something mom.
What was the last one?
My ride home, that's what it says. Thank you, it's never enough, but that you, but thank you for always being my ride home mom. And there's a blue card and your, or $1,000 and $50 in the photograph. And on the photograph on the phone, it does say November 20th or 27th.
Judge, I reserve the right to move it into evidence in a different format.
Sure.
Okay. I just have a couple more questions for Mr. Saunders. Okay. Now, Mr. Saunders, when was that photograph taken?
It was taken November 20th, 2007.
Is that indicated on the photograph?
Yes.
And is that the same photograph that you tried to show Detective Engelhardt when during the interview?
Yes.
The very same picture?
Yes.
And when you tried to show it to him, he actually had the phone in his hand, is that correct? Did Officer Engelhardt have your phone in his hand when you tried to show him?
I'm not quite sure if he had the phone in his hand. I know I told him if he get the phone, he can hold the phone. And I said, I'll move the screen so we get to the picture.
I understand, but I guess my question is more this. Had he taken your phone from
you? Yes, he took my phone from
And when you were asking to access your phone, He hadn't given you your phone back yet?
No.
When he gave you the phone back, he hadn't looked at it, as far as you know?
As far as I know.
Officer Robbins, he came in and he located John Small that day out in the yard with K2, as it turns out. Is it accurate that you and Robbins came in together?
Yes.
Were, at any point during the beginning of that shift, were you ever in Unit 6 when before Robbins came in?
No.
When you came in on that day, when you first came to work, before John Small was captured out in the yard, had you had any contact with a Cobian Shepherd before that moment?
No.
Had you had any contact with John Small before that moment?
No.
Did you have anything to do with the contraband John Small was caught with that day?
No.
Have you ever had a discussion with John Small about bringing contraband into this facility?
Never.
Ever had a conversation with a Cobian Shepherd about bringing contraband into the facility?
Never.
Ever had a conversation with Shepherd about getting paid for anything?
Never.
That's all I have.
Just briefly.
Yeah,
Mr. Saunders, do you, I don't know what you've testified to, that you, that Ms. Swain did give you marijuana on the night of the 20th?
Yes, she did.
She did, okay. And you knew she was giving you marijuana?
No.
You did not?
No.
Okay. At what point did you realize she had given you marijuana?
The point I realized it was when, after she had left, and I pulled off the drive, and I'm driving home, and then I just started smelling.
And you didn't notice the smell when you received it?
No.
Did you provide any information to the police about how you came in possession of it?
They asked me, how did you get it? Didn't tell the people. Asked me, what were you doing? I said, she gave me a bag. She came into the car, gave me a bag. I started. But the money that was.
Did you know her full name at that time? When you got pulled over?
Yeah.
Did you tell them the full name? Or?
They just asked me, they just showed the picture, said, you know this guy? I said, yeah, that's Tisha.
You didn't know her last name?
They didn't ask you the last name.
Okay, so I know they didn't ask you.
Right.
But did you know her last name?
Yeah, I thought last name.
You knew it was Swain. All right, Mr. Gilmore.
Told all the inmates that you didn't want any rats and snitches in Unit 6, right? You would tell them all as they came in, I don't want any rats, I don't want any snitches on my unit. You actually used those words,
correct? Yeah, I used those words.
And you said that every time a new group of inmates came in.
It was orientation.
Your orientation.
Well,
right?
my orientation, new man orientation.
You ran your unit how you want it, right?
Pretty much.
That probably includes the younger officers that were your partners on the unit too, right? They defer to you?
I told them, you be your own officer.
Didn't you also tell them, come to me, I'm sort of the man here, I'll make sure everything is smoothed over, that there's no issues?
No.
Well, didn't you tell inmates, don't mess with my partner, you come to me, as if you're the highest authority in that unit?
Oh, as far as the inmates?
Right.
Oh, yes.
So the inmates, in their minds, you're the boss. Your partner is below you, right?
No.
Why would they come to you and not your partner?
When I have told them that you have situations where inmate would say to me, as far as officers, you never say specific names. They would say as far as officers, whatever. But like, if we ask an officer a question, they would say something smart or something disrespectful.
Okay, that doesn't really answer my question. Why would you want the inmates to come to you instead of going to your partner?
Because at times inmate would say they know like if we were, let's say, out on the streets, they wouldn't be talking to each other. So I sit there and say, well, look, to avoid all that and to avoid any problems as far as with you and the officer that's working over here, whether the regular, the relief, they just here doing the breaks, or they just here from during that day. If you have a problem, instead of asking them, you come ask me.
Because you're the man.
No, I'm not saying I'm the man.
You're the great song.
No, I'm not saying
there's an argument.
No.
That's a little argument. Right. At least the great song.
Well, didn't you tell them?
Miss Swain.
Didn't you tell Kobe and Shepard no one's ever going to catch you or the great Saunders?
I never told Shepard that.
You knew that SID might be looking into you, but they weren't going to catch you because you were too smart. You're the great Saunders.
I never said that.
And you testified in redirect that you turned over beds, that you searched beds, right?
Yes.
Cool. Isn't that your job?
Yes.
You're required to do that
all
the time, right?
Yes.
It's just part of your job.
Yes.
It's not any special thing that you did whatever you're required to do during the rotation. Is it? That's just your job.
That's part of the job.
Because you're trying to prevent contraband, or you should be trying to prevent contraband from coming into Southern State Correctional Facility.
I sit here, I do my job.
Well, you don't work there anymore, do you?
You used to do your job,
right? While you were there?
Yeah, I used to do my job.
Sometimes, right?
You say that.
When you met with Tasha Swain on November 20th, and she gave you a bag that had marijuana in it, and oxycodone in it, and tobacco in it, she testified, and you told the officers, you didn't pay her money, did you? You didn't pay her for the drugs that she brought, did you?
No.
You didn't pay her for the marijuana?
No, first of all, I didn't know she was bringing the drugs.
Well, that's not what I asked you. You knew. Did you pay her for the marijuana that she brought you?
I did not know she was bringing the drugs.
So
I went there to go with me.
Objection, Your Honor, non-responsive.
The answer would be, the literal answer, obviously, is no. And it's because you didn't know that that's what you're getting. That's his answer.
And you didn't pay her for the oxycodone either. Did you? You didn't give her money when she met you on November 20th for oxycodone or marijuana.
She gave me a bag. I wanted me to give the money that she gave.
Just one last question for you. You just testified that when the officers asked you, they showed you a picture of Tasha Swain. You called her Tisha?
Yeah.
Is that right?
presume that Ms. Swain knew that she was supposed to be in her house.
Yes.
When you received the, I guess the package, where it was just one item, one package?
Yes.
And did you check to see if she had given you $300 at that moment?
Not at that moment.
You just presumed that it was $300, I guess?
Yes.
And what, you trusted her, believed her, you were in your mind having
yes.
some sort of relationship with her. And so you figured, if I'm getting this amount of money, I'm satisfied without looking at it in the moment.
Yes.
That is $300.
Yes.
Were you, I take it you were surprised or shocked that this woman you had gotten to know over these 7 months gave you marijuana?
Your Honor, based
yes.
on that, we would like to play one more clip from that interview.
You heard a stop bar, Jim?